There is a widespread false understanding of what time, space, and gravity are, regardless of education. Physicists have noticed that all these phenomena are interconnected. We often hear that time flies, as if it was some river in which we are immersed. It is not true. We should ask what phenomenon time describes. Time describes the phenomenon of change, nothing more. If there was no change, there would be no such thing as time. We do not experience time. We are experiencing change. We measure time using phenomena that repeat periodically. This means that we measure time by change, not change by time. Time describes change, so it is an internal parameter of our universe. Time cannot be used to explain why the Big Bang occurred. Belief in time leads to absurd questions like, what happened before the Big Bang? It's like asking what changed before anything existed. It is equally idiotic to consider the possibility of time travel. Time is not a space in which you can move. Going back in time would mean that all phenomena from that moment on would start to unfold as if they were in a movie played in reverse. To go back in time would mean reversing all processes in the entire universe while excluding the time traveler and the device that initiates such great changes from these changes. Similarly, traveling to the future would mean the acceleration of all processes in the entire universe with the exception of the time traveler and his device that is capable of forcing such a process. Physicists are largely responsible for the false idea of time. They believed in a mathematical trick used by Minkowski, who invented an abstract four-dimensional space to describe the relationship between motion and the measurement of time. They believed that it was a real object. For this reason, some of them even claim that everything has already happened, that the past and the future already exist. The slowing down of clocks in a gravitational field and the gravitational field in general can be described equally well by assuming that we have flat space on the largest scale, but with locally moving space. Just as we often explain what a black hole is by depicting it as a kind of a waterfall of space, in which space moves in towards the black hole from a certain distance from it at a speed greater than the speed of light, which prevents even light from escaping from it, because it moves relative to space at the known speed of light in the vacuum. Presenting the phenomenon of gravity as the accelerated motion of space, assuming that light moves with this space and does not change its speed relative to space, and assuming that bodies endowed with mass feel the resistance of space only when they move with acceleration relative to it, it allows us to explain the slowing down of clocks in the gravitational field, the existence of black holes, and the radius of photon orbit. This is the orbit in which light can move around a black hole, based on the spatial theory of relativity, which does not assume the existence of a gravitational field. Gravitational acceleration would then be the acceleration of space relative to points with zero gravitational field intensity far away from bodies endowed with mass. Moreover, in this approach, the principle of equivalence formulated by Einstein, which states that locally it is impossible to distinguish motion with acceleration in a space without a gravitational field from the phenomenon of gravity, is obvious, because both have their cause in motion with acceleration relative to space. This concept explains in a trivial way why, on the largest scale at which we observe the universe, experimental results indicate that at this scale the curvature of space is zero, which for physicists using the general theory of relativity to describe the phenomenon of gravity seems to be some miraculous coincidence that cannot be explained. According to the theory explaining gravity through the movement of space, this is obvious because on a larger scale, with the uniform distribution of matter on this scale, local movements of space neutralize each other. Perhaps this could explain the excessive speed of stars in spiral galaxies and the excessive speed of galaxies in galaxy clusters by the movement of space being dragged along by rotating stars and galaxies. They would not only undergo the acceleration of space towards the center of the system, but would also gain additional speed in the direction tangential to the velocity due to the rotating space. Inventing the existence of dark matter might then be completely unnecessary. We must remember that dark matter was invented to save Einstein's general theory of relativity, because without it, the experimental facts would not be consistent with it on a larger scale. The fact that to this day, for several dozen years, no one has found even a single particle of dark matter should lead to the search for alternative solutions. Unfortunately, most universities have been taken over by physicists who have devoted several dozen years of their lives to searching for dark matter, and who would perceive the abandonment of this concept as proof of the senselessness of their actions. Therefore, they do not only invent dark matter, but select its features so that the experimental facts can be explained based on the general theory of relativity, and if subsequent measurements do not meet this condition, they assign new features to the dark matter that restore compliance with the general theory of relativity. String theory is undergoing a similar process, subsequent versions of which turned out to be incorrect and were saved by introducing patches that restored consistency with experience, which most often consisted of adding additional dimensions of space. General relativity on a smaller scale gives results very similar to measurements, but on a larger scale, galaxies and groups of galaxies, it differs dramatically from the measurements. It is more likely that it is not fully true, and on a smaller scale, it is only an approximation of a more general theory, than that it is always true and requires the assumption of existence of a huge amount of dark matter that no one has ever found. Perhaps dark matter exists, but for today, sticking to this prosthesis of the general theory of relativity can only be explained by a psychiatrist analyzing the minds of thousands of physicists who have devoted their lives to searching for dark matter and do not want to admit their mistake.